Please, can you put your mask on your face in the room? It's mandatory here. Thank you. It to have better performance. So just let me adjust the title of the conf. Yeah. It's about PHP 2. Thank you.
1 more minute.
1 more minute?
Okay. Again, just before we start, I have to remind everybody that we are still under strict mask mandate. I'm sorry to be the guy who has to say that, but it's still the fact. So please put up your masks.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. By anticipation, sorry for my broken English. I'm French, and that's all. Okay. I'm here to speak about Drupal and PHP performances. It's very important. It's not a deep dive into performances with PHP. It's just some tips and tricks, and to have a better understanding how to have better performance with your code, with your PHP ecosystem, with your hosting. That's why some tips I would like to share with you, okay? So donc, I'm Nicolas Perussel, I'm working at Ekino and as a PHP lead senior. I come from Symfony World, okay? Don't judge me, but it's a very good community and a lot of best practice, donc, that's why I'm here. So this talk is not about web performances. I don't speak about how to tune your front end with some tips. It's not about this. It's not a talk to try to give you some better tips to be a better coder, better developer. It's not this. And it's not an architecture call. Okay? Architecture talk. So let's go. Some Drupal performance generalities. Maybe some of this advice are obvious, but let's just me speak about. For me, it's very important to use the last version of your language, PHP. That's why when you use PHP 8 or newer version, it's very important. Why? Because you have gains immediately. It's very important. You can have around 7% of gain just to switch between set 7.4 and 8 and 8.1. It's very important. It's free and you can have better performance just to upgrade your PHP version. A common thing to say is to avoid to install a lot of modules. Why? Because when you install module, you have the discovery phase into Drupal. It's very intensive operation. You have a lot of code parsing. But in production, we don't want this. We want to avoid to parse PHP files that don't we want to use. That's why you need to short to bypass all the things that you've broke your performance. An interesting thing to be, it's to be defensive. I don't know if in the Drupal community you are very defensive. It's a reference of defensive programming, but it's very important to be defensive, early exit and so on, to try to reduce the runtime of your PHP runtime. Okay? It's an important advice. You can see a lot of literature on the internet. It's very interesting. A common thing to do is to use the PHP CSS fixers, to use FQFN, to benefit of your opcode inlining function. Do you know what opcode inlining? No? Sorry, but it's very important on certain PHP function, you can add a backslash before to try to optimize the opcode produced by the PHP engine. And with this, it can be a gain of performance. Inside the Symfony framework, it was a huge gain to prefix some PHP function with a backslash. It's not useful to backslash all your function inside your code, but certain function provide opcode inlining, and it's very important to use. You can easily fix this with PHP CSS fixer. Sorry, with PHP CSS fixer inside the CI, inside your local development, for example. Okay. Another thing is to use the container injection dependency like a symphonist. Usage, you can use tag, you can use compiler pass and other things to avoid to detect all your work and at a time inside your hook. Better you compile this and better you put this in the cache in the table container, it's better. The service provider base provides a base class to provide some interface to implement to which provides the definition service alteration, by example, who provides the compiler class into the container. It's common with Symfony, but less with Drupal. You use this, it's very powerful. Avoid to load unnecessary entities. I think it's obvious because it's memory intensive. Sometimes it can be a CPU intensive. No, avoid to make this. It's my advice, it's not my opinion. Avoid to use Vue for any needs. Sometimes write SQL, raw SQL with a dedicated cache is better than use the UI and use the Vue. We don't want to parse PHP that we don't want to use. It's the same, it's already the same. Okay? And for me, sometimes write your dedicated code. Disable watchdog on production. Seems obvious to me too, and prefer usage of monologue. Who is using monologue in production? Ah, good, very good. It's very powerful, and you can create channel and then store lots of different logs, and performance is really better than to use the watchdog. Watchdog is based on the database, and we won't want to deal with the database often, because the TCP calls can be less powerful that work with direct files or in PHP files. So we don't want to make to perform some TCP calls because you have a lot of transaction with TCP and check and so on. We don't want this. And you can log SQL query, it's the slow log query, and use the explain keyword to track bottleneck inside your SQL. Okay? This is common, but maybe not, I don't know. And a very important thing to know is use internal cache. By default, Drupal uses in this internal cache, but it uses it inside the database, and we don't want to make this to have better performance in production. I'll try to explain in the next chapter what is a cache backend and how to configure it and how to optimize it. It's important, okay? Here is a schema from AWS to how to host a scalable Drupal and Drupal with performance. It's common for large projects. Okay, there is no pain point here. You have, for example, the usage of CDN. Here is CloudFront. Can be Fastly, Akamai, or other things. You need to have better performance. You need to use S3 storage instead of EFS, like NFS Montage Point, because here is really fast. S3 protocol is faster than access the file system. And it's very interesting to use. it's very interesting to use S3 instead of the file system. You have some module in Drupal to use S3 file system, by example. It can be a mess it can be difficult to configure sometimes, but if you have encrypt links, this module is not perfect, but it's really good to begin to work with. Here you have the scalability with auto-scaling group. We deploy a CDU instance, and each instance contains a Drupal instance, which manages service. Here, we have Memcached. We can use Redis. I really prefer to use Redis. I speak about Redis after. Aurora, it's a RDS managed service. You can use PostgreSQL. You have better performances with PostgreSQL than the usage of MySQL or MariaDB. All my Drupal project turns with PostgreSQL. You need to patch some modules to adjust type hinting inside SQL. But it's really, well, I don't speak about PostgreSQL because we don't have the time, but it's really a powerful database. And so on, you have the file system mount here. And you have the auto-scaling. The traffic is increased. Auto-scaling creates a seed instance with different Drupal instance. This is a basic scalability of Drupal. You can use, instead of the usage of Amazon CloudFront, you can use here Varnish Cache. But the problem in this type of scalability, you need to invalidate Varnish on each SQL instance, on its front-end instance of your application. Well, don't use Varnish, use a CDN, it's better. You can invalidate your cache with a purger module with different adapter. There is an adapter for CloudFront, there is an adapter for Akamai and so on. So it can be, it's better. Why I would like to share with you this type of our architecture? It's because you need to understand all the stream between your different pieces inside your infrastructure and how to optimize it. Drupal, it's PHP, but PHP, it's a proxy pass from Nginx. I advise to use Nginx, really better than Apache. And you send request inside Nginx, which is a reverse proxy. You send it to Varnish. Varnish speaks with the backend and so on. There is a lot of TCP connection between all these pieces, and you have locked you lost time in each layer. Okay. We don't want this, and we want to try to be faster than checks. We call the DB. We have the response. We call the. It's not possible to make this, and it's very difficult to parallelize this communication. So here is a whole tweet from Srigi. It's a human comprehension of the time which is going on inside your computer. It's very important. And latency numbers that every programmer should know. And as you can see, an internet connection on HTTP, external call or TCP, is really, really huge. 40 milliseconds is equal to 4 years in human time. When you speak with the database, this is the time. Okay? You can already hear different cache level from your CPU, and we want to be very fast. We want the data in our pocket very fastly. That's why we use cache level 1 as soon as possible. But this is a CPU. Huh? We can't perform. But PHP most of the time deals with Linux operating system, and Linux operating system make lot of calls, system call, and system call deals with level 1, level 2, level 3. Okay? Okay, donc it just generally, just for fun, I think it's very interesting to know and to have in mind. So, what is a cache backend? Everybody knows what is a cache backend inside Drupal. You put a. Okay, no, I don't. You must know you can create as bin as you want, and you can create handler or connect handler to these bins as you want. It's very easy to create a bin, a dedicated bin, hein, donc a dedicated storage location to store your dedicated data. It's not a good idea to put the data inside the core bins or module. I prefer to have an isolation to invalidate my cache after. And you can create this. How can you create bins? It's very easy. It's inside the DI. It's only an implement. You need to subscribe to a tag and so on. Okay. A bin is directly connected with the cache backend. Each cache backend implements the cache backend interface. You can implement your dedicated cache backend, which is already implemented is one cache backend. Nobody? Okay. I'm alone. OK. Alors, bins are collected by the compiler list cache bin path. OK? Donc, just for information, you have the compiler path, it detects the bin because you have subscribed to a tag and so. I don't want to go further in details here, but OK? But you need to know different cache backend to have a better configuration of your performance with this. OK? The default backend for Drupal, it's provided by the core, is a database backend. What does it mean? Everything, when Drupal puts some items in the cache, it stores it into the database. It's the default behavior. OK? It's slow, really slow. Too slow. It's not, if you have a huge traffic, if you need to handle a lot of requests, it's not the good solution to use inside your application. OK? Moreover, there is a default constant that is set into the database backend, or just a part of here of the database backend. It's a default max rows. What does it mean? Each cache table contains by default only 5,000 of lines. That's all. If you want to store more, you trigger an invalidation cache into your production server. We don't want this. It's a performance killer. You can upgrade the default behavior inside the settings like this, and you get configure for each bins the number of rows. By example, the cache container table no need to have this value. Only one row, okay? It's sharing between the requests. There is different type of other cache. The null cache backend, I don't speak this, it's not important. The memory cache backend, not important. The usage for test, for example. The PHP cache backend, it's the faster cache that we will be used. But the problem is that when the, donc it creates some PHP file, and at runtime, time, PHP file I put inside the opcode, if opcache is enabled. But it's hard to invalidate. That was, it's not a good idea to put your cache inside. And if you are in auto-scaling infra, your cache is inside your front-end one, not in front-end two. It's not shared between, you can't create NFS because it's slow and so on. It's not a good solution, but it is faster. So the Drupal core creates the fast chain backend. Who is using the fast chain backend? Voilà. We are three. Okay. Now the fast chain backend is very, very interesting because when you deal with, you want to get some items. And the first thing that this cache makes, it's to fetch IPCU. IPCU is a memory in cache database. It's a shortcut, but we can say this. And if item is found, ici, is a green path, item is found, item are returned, is really fast, because it's in memory. And with IPCU, is it shared memory between your different PHP process? Okay? It's perfect. But if the items are not found, you need to fetch the other backend. Your other backend can be Redis, Memcached, PostgreSQL, MySQL, whatever. Items is cached inside the backend. Items I store into IPCU and value as returned. The next time I want the items, it's inside IPCU, it's faster. That was, it's called chain fast backend. Okay? Nothing to say more about this. But we can configure Redis to have better performance. We don't want to use the database, so we need to store data in some location. And the best location for me is Redis. Which is using Redis with is Drupal? Okay, it's common. It's good. So to use Redis, you need to install Redis like this. It's not so difficult to understand. The The not easy step to understand is the redefinition of the bootstrap container definition. Here, when Drupal is booted, it need to understand how to deal with the database with Redis. That's why we need to create a small container, Symfony container, and not Symfony, dependent injection container, a very small container, which is able to work with the true container, which is stored inside Redis or inside your database or inside APCU or inside whatever. Okay? That's why you need to redefine some service and create this service. And here we are redefining the Bootstrap container definition. By default, you can get the service container definition from an API. By example, it can be an ID. You can make a lot of things with this. It's very powerful. And it's made during the Drupal kernel load. And after, you register some services in our settings. And by default, we are saying use cache backend.redis. It's a cache backend provided by the Redis module to use. Okay. Normally, is a common way to use Redis. It's not mandatory to enable Redis because this module can work without enable Redis. Services are registered. You can use the service, no problem. And Redis the Redis module just provides some statistics. And we don't want this because it's stored into the database. We don't want to make this. Okay? Donc it just so tips, you no need to enable the Redis module. And when Redis is active on your production, is Pantheon gives this schema, you can see that the database load is decreased significantly. It's better. Okay? But by default, you use the PHP serialize function. The normalizer with PHP, donc serialize and unserialize function. We can go further with IGBinary, which is using IGBinary to deal with Redis and other things. Good. It's perfect. So here is an example on how to install IGBinary with Redis inside the Docker file, a common use case. The important thing is to say to Redis to compile with the APCU, with the IGBinary extension. And then what is IGBinary? IGBinary is a drop-in replacement for the standard PHP serializer. IGBinary stores PHP data structures in compact binary form. It means the strings are stored not in the compact way, binary way, not with the string, standard string. The aim is to compact the message and to have better unserialization inside your application. With this, you reduce the TCP TRAM by % It depends on your application. You save time, you save memory, you save a lot of things. It's very, very cool. There is IGBinary, but there is also another extension, which is Compact. But Compact have less performance as IGBinary. Okay, IGBinary is working fine with PHP 8.2. It's not a problem. You can use the two things. Let me show the next. Sorry. Here is a proof. you don't to trust me, but it's the truth, and you have the benchmark comparison into the GitHub repository of IGBinary. Here is a standard with PHP 8, okay? By default, 1. We have lower time with the serialize function. PHP function is better to serialize, but we have better time with unserialized function than PHP. And it's very important because we serialize sometimes and we unserialize often. It's not important to, when you say RS data, it's not the fastest way to make. It's not important. But to unserialize your application exists a lot of time during your request, with the handle of the request, okay? So to enable IG binary with Redis inside Drupal, the Drupal application, not so difficult. Here we have the Bootstrap container definition. We are creating the service, your dedicated service to handle IG binary. Here we are defining the serialization .IG binary underscore serializer. It's a small class that implements the serializer interface from the core. And just here, you substitute serialize with IG binary underscore serialize. And you have gains. It's cool. I think it's not so difficult to implement. It's an easy way to make this. Okay. So now we know how cache backend works. You can play with the different configuration of your bins, and by default we are setting the whole bins into Redis cache. But the Bootstrap and discovery, very important bins to Drupal to boot. But I use the cache backend chain fast. I want to use APCU before to use Redis. What does it mean? Okay. And after, you have different bins. I don't know how. It's not a recipe. You need to detect your bins and find and make some adjustments. And for the other bins, you can define maybe cache backend database, because for these bins particularly, you have better performance with. Okay. You can play with and find and make some fine tuning to have better configuration. So now I'm speaking about PHP opcode. If you don't know what is PHP opcode, you have the opcode explained here with this schema on here. Okay. And the important things to know is that parsing PHP file, create token with the Alexa and so on, it's intensive. That's why we don't want to make this operation for all our requests. We want to share our bytecode between PHP. That's why we need to cache it. And to cache it, it just enables the OP cache inside your application. If you want to monitor your opcode, you can use this tool, cache tool. It's a very powerful tool. It gives some statistics inside your application, and you can invalidate the opcode. I think it's a good project. To enable the PHP opcode, you need to enable the extension here. And you need to increase some value, because Drupal, it's like Symfony. It uses lot of files, and we need to compute this inside the. We don't want to break our opcache. That's what we need to increase the memory consumption. We need to increase the max accelerated files. It's how your system detects the files. It's important. And I think the most important things to know is to create this. Donc opcache.validate underscore timestamp equals to zero. What does it mean? If you go to your production and you write some PHP code in production, don't make this, huh? but you save your files, nothing has happened, because we don't have the revalidation of your cache. It's already in the opcode cache, and you are safe with this. But when you are deploying a next version of your application, you need to invalidate the cache inside PHP FPM. It's important, imagine you deploy a new version, but you don't invalidate your opcache. You are serving partially your older application with a new one. It's dangerous. So, yeah. But with this, you have really, really, really gains. Okay. So now we are speaking about PHP and PHP FPM. Not just here, the real cache size need to be increased because there is lot of files inside the Drupal project. That's why we need to put an extra settings here. We are to increase the value of these settings. You need to make this. Same for the real cache TTL. Here you have the reason why. Because when PHP detects your files, in fact, the PHP C function use system calls function like stat. A stat is very intensive for your OS. That's why we want to put the cache inside the PHP engine and not inside the system engine. Okay? There is a lot of things to understand here. It's very important. Some tips here. You can use IG binary with APCU to have better performance. APC.serializer equals to IG binary. So now you have IG binary strings, binary strings into the APCU cache very fast. You can dump the autoloader like this with the class map auto-autorative. What does it mean? You files are detected and written into PHP file, and that's finished. There is no more discovery. You know the file. If the file is missing, problem. But with this, you have a lot of performance due to stat function inside your OS. This thing is very interesting. You can set the composer autoloader into a PCU instead of PHP file to have better performance. It's some tips, but you can have some gains with this. How about PHP FPM? As you know, there is three different type of worker type: static, dynamic, and on-demand. Most of the time, we use the on-demand, we use the dynamic worker pool definition, but it's not a good solution to have better performance. For low traffic site, you need to use on-demand worker. Okay, and for high traffic site, you need to use the static worker. You define exactly the number of workers that you want, and that's all. Because when you are in the static and on-demand, you have an overhead to generate the PHP, to fork the PHP FPM process. It's not a good idea. To have better performance, use static. But you need to make some statistics about your PHP FPM before to adjust this configuration. Here you have a small calcul method to find how to set up correctly for the dynamic type and on-demand type the number of workers that you want. And you need to pre-production server, use stress test and load testing to see how your PHP FPM behavior is. You can use Hey, it's an utility written in Go, very powerful and fun, and K6. K6, this is the same, written in Go, and very, very powerful. When you are in a stress situation on your infrastructure or application, you can enable the PHP FPM status pass, /FPM status, which gives you some information in direct of your child, of your children, and memory consumption, and so on. You have different, you can get the result into JSON, XML, or HTML if you want to make this. You need to create some Nginx location. Well, it's not so difficult. You can search on the web. It's very interesting to do. And if you want to have better settings of this, it's inside your pre-production server and not on your production server. We try to be preventive. And not, we don't want to wait to be in production to adjust some settings. Okay, it's very important. Another thing we can speak, but I don't know if I have the time. It's to speak about PHP FPM load balancing. You can load balance your PHP FPM socket between different parts of your application by the hardest things to do here is to split your Drupal application. It's not so easy to bypass the admin pass and to bypass the front-end pass and our different API pass. Here it's just a pattern on the URI, but it's not maybe the better way to do. Okay, but you can load balance your PHP FPM and so on, have different configuration of your pool definition to have better isolation and performance and to better adjusting your PHP FPM. To speak about Nginx, we can use different type of cache inside Nginx, but the aim with this is an invalidation of this cache. You can use a FastCGI cache directive to configure your cache. It's very, very powerful because we don't speak with PHP because the result is already in cache. Donc you can say an example of the configuration here. But we have the same with the proxy cache. If you have Nginx as a reverse proxy to Varnish, by example, Varnish is in the sandwich mode, which is called with the backend. You can, before to proxy cache to Varnish, you can have a cache here to have better performance inside your reverse proxy. Before to have the response of Varnish, you have the response from Nginx, which is in mode a reverse proxy. Better, because we are no go down inside the infrastructure. We are in the highest pieces of your infra. Okay? It's not Drupal, but it's very powerful. You can enable HTTP 2 or HTTP 3. If you enable HTTP 2, it's easy. It's only to add HTTP 2 into the listen directive. You have gain directly. Easy and powerful. Most of the hosting makes this, but it's very powerful. And if you are an adventurer, you can use Quick, the new protocol based on UDP, HTTP 3, but it's still experimental on Nginx. You can enable JZIP or Brotli compression. If you can active Brotli compression inside your Nginx configuration, really better than JZIP. And you can use cache assets with an expires max like this. You can set a lot of extension. It's just an example here. With this, you have a good performance with Nginx. There is a lot of things to say, but we don't have the time to speak about. But this is, for me, this is the base to have better performance with PHP with Nginx. The end, I would like to speak about Blackfire, which is using Blackfire with Drupal. Some people, okay. It's very, Blackfire is a code profiling. The aim is to find bottleneck inside the runtime of your application. Drupal handles the request, and gives a response, and makes lot of things between these two parts. And you write code inside these two parts. And XSageProf or Blackfire tries to help to find bottleneck inside your application. XSageProf is an old project from Facebook. It may be it's ugly. It's not so fun to use. Better is to use Blackfire. You have a hack edition for free, but you just have the work wall time and the CPU work time. You don't have network, I/O, database. It's expensive. Huh? It's a tool that is expensive but very powerful. We use it a lot of on our project. And why we using this? It's to create Blackfire insertion. We are monitoring our performance during the build phase of our application. It means we can create some basic tests like this here. Okay, and we don't want to have, by example, we don't want to have so much SQL query on the home page. We don't want to have a peak memory superior to this value. We don't want to have a network out superior to this value. Maybe because I want to speak to Redis, it's a network calls. We don't want to use lot of TCP call. Okay, and when you write this, it's very interesting to make. And when you are stressing your application, you can audit your performance during your build phase. You can block the CI/CD because the performance is not here, and du coup you can review your MR and write to better coding. Okay, You can couple this with their boost or SQL CI to monitor your web performance, and with this you have really good performance inside your application. Okay. I encourage to try to use this type of tool. It's you can win a lot of things, a lot of gains. As a conclusion, to conclude, my last advice is searching for performance resolution can be expensive in terms of cost and time. It's not so easy to track the performance and to be better. You install this, it's not directly, again, for some tips. You need to work with, or try to find what is going on inside your application. It's not so easy. This type of tips don't make better PHP code. Okay, you only need to have a better conception, try to be defensive, try to write less code, try to be decoupled from Drupal. There is a lot of things to do before, but as you must know that it's a cost, okay, for your project. No need to focus on micro optimization, ESET versus Ariki exist, by example. It's not a problem. You can use Rector to make this. You can use PHP CS Fixer. You can use PHP standard rules. You can make a lot of things that helps to have better performance in micro optimization. Okay, no need to focus on it. Search for performance is not for all project typologies. If you work for a small project, you don't need to make this. It's not a problem. But if you work with a big company with a huge traffic, you have this problem. But normally, you have the team and the time to try to make the things that you do to have better performance. For me, it's a collaborative work. It's not only a PHP work. You need to work with your PHP team, share your knowledge often. You need to speak with your DevOps team. PHP and DevOps, for me, must be the same, but you can if you have a dedicated team, you need to speak with how to PHP works, how to, maybe they have some knowledge to share with you. It's very important. You need to understand how the system works, how Linux works. It's very important to try to find performance. That's why the communication with the system team, if you have, it's important. For the front-end part, you need to deal with HTTP2, performance, web performance, and other things. Donc, do not only focus on PHP, but its ecosystem. And when you are writing PHP code, it's PHP plus PHP FPM plus Varnish plus Redis plus Memcached plus OS, the OS operating system, and a lot of things. You need to understand all the pieces. And an advice, be not only a site builder, be a deep dive PHP developer. Try to search how PHP works. Try to find the things, how it's working, how Drupal is working, how the core is built, how the core is, what is the hoop conception of the core, for example. Try to deep dive into each subject to have a better understanding and to find the best solution to your problem. And sorry, but Drupal is not always a good solution for the project. Drupal is a good project, huge project, but sometimes you don't need to deploy Drupal to make your project. You can use PHP RAW, you can use Symfony, Laravel, whatever, Laminas. You can use WordPress, maybe. I don't know, but just keep in mind that Drupal, I don't know. I don't use WordPress, okay. But for me, it's my opinion. Drupal, as an architect, is not always a good solution. It solves a lot of problematics for a huge project, but not often. You can replace some parts of Drupal with other things and deal with. Try to be creative to create some microservices and so on. Okay. So, thank you. To listen to you. If you have some feedback, don't hesitate to come with me or feel this. Thank you.
Excuse me, we have one question from